Is it possible that strange, old, dusty stories have what it takes to guide us through our complicated, unequal, absurd, crisis-ridden, and very much on fire modern world? Peperina! No! I'm going to put her on the bed.
Amethi papi! Ameri methi papi.
People in all ages and corners of the world have always made up stories. Myths and folktales are simply the way that we've made sense of the world for ages and ages of the existence of humanity. If you like to hear and learn about stories, do subscribe to my channel down below and click the notification bell to be, well, notified.
Notified.
And before you continue watching the rest of the video, I would like to know your unfiltered opinion. Do you think that folktales and legends have something useful to teach us today? If so, what do you think that is? I think we really shouldn't take the messages from folktales uncritically. After all, there's such stuff in there as obey your parents, even when they try to dump you in the forest. Never try to improve your financial situation, because that is absolutely immoral. Offending people who are different just because being different is evil, right? But there are still, I think, seeds of truths and symbolisms that we can dig out and recover from these stories. And perhaps one of today's four pieces of folktale advice will be useful as a tool to solve a particular situation or as a general compass to guide our action. Let us get into it, shall we? This is some intensity. I feel like those agony ants. Folktale agony ant. Treat the world around you as a person because it is. The economic system that runs our world and all the mental constructs that support it function through objectification or reification. According to the philosopher Lucas, the transformation of human beings into thing-like beings which do not behave in a human way but according to the laws of the thing world. Reification is a special case of alienation. So this is basically treating living humans or living beings as objects. And it also makes us feel isolated and alone in our cold, empty world. In Marxist theory, this term refers to the objectification of humans, right? Treating humans like the workforce, disposable, interchangeable, exploitable commodities. But many think that it goes the other way too. We can only exploit nature, doubling down on fossil fuel extraction, or destroying habitats like wetlands to build luxury apartments, because we see nature as a thing that's separate for us, there for us to use, and certainly not a sentient person. In folktales though, we find a very different attitude towards the non-human world. In the German version of Cinderella, the person who helps the heroine and gives her a beautiful ball gown isn't a fairy godmother, but a hazel tree that she has planted, tended to, and built a relationship with. And there are also lots of stories of humans who befriend and help wild animals. In Rose Red and Snow White, different Snow White, the two kind sisters find a bear at the beginning of the winter right on their doorstep. He asks them to go in the house because he's freezing. I don't suggest you do this. They open the door to him and allow him to spend the winter with them. In the end, they're rewarded when the bear turns back into a human prince and marries one of the sisters. In another German tale, Frau Holle, the unnamed heroine accidentally drops a spindle into a well, and as she goes to look for it, she falls in too. But the well turns out to be a whole different world with meadows and trees, and when she's in there, she goes through a series of tests of her character. First, she helps a burning loaf of bread that asks to be taken out of the oven. Then she harvests the apples from an apple tree that asked for her help in shaking off this heavy load on its branches. And finally, she helps Frau Holle, who is this magical old witch doing things around the house like sweeping and making the bed. In the end, Frau Holle rewards her with a lot of gold. The ethics of these fairy tales tell us that we should treat the beings that we interact with, human or non-human, as people with their own independent lives and desires and spirits, treat them with respect and try to do right by them. I think this goes against what is being taught to us by our system, which is to use non-human beings as if they were things. I also believe that slowly cultivating this folktale attitude towards the non-human world might help us remedy that feeling of intense aloneness in the world, don't you think? Question mark. Remember, everything has a cost. In the story I just mentioned, Frau Holle, the heroine isn't just handed the gold as she falls through the well, she works for it. But also achieving something isn't necessarily about work, as in a job. There are other things besides currency that we may want, and there are other costs to achieve them. In yet another German tale called The Seven Ravens, the youngest sister of 8 siblings saves her 7 older brothers who have been turned into, you guessed it, ravens, by being silent for 7 years, never laughing, never even explaining what is going on to her new husband, never defending herself from slander. And in the Scottish ballad Thomas the Rhymer, the son of a nobleman spends 7 years as the lover and servant of the Queen of Fairy in Elfland, and as a reward he receives a tongue that cannot lie, which is on one hand a good thing, known as the most accurate prophet, but he can never speak to a prince in a flattering way or ask the favor of a lady ever again. And, well, this is not a folktale, but in The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, both Bilbo and Frodo have adventures, acquire fame and treasure and experience, and they even save the world, but they both pay a price for this. When they come back from their adventures, they can no longer inhabit the same world as before. They are never the same again, constantly long for places far away. They don't fit in the Hobbit society anymore, and in the end, they have to depart the mortal world entirely. Anything and everything we do has a cost. Great effort, endurance, unpredictable changes in our personality. Or maybe it's simply the cost of all the paths we did not choose. Personally, this inspires me to be very intentional with the things I choose, but obviously I'm not perfect. But when I finished high school, I felt the pressure, because I was smart and because the people in my social circle normally do that, to go to college and get a degree, which I didn't really want to do. If I could go back, I would choose to learn more practical skills instead of putting myself through many years of university that I wasn't really interested in. So yeah, that decision definitely had a cost. But even when we choose things that we love, we are abandoning other paths that we might have also loved. Our lives are just irreversible. So I think this is telling us to actively choose the cost that we are willing to pay. Walk into the forest, even when you're afraid. In another video, I told you the story of Vasilisa the Beautiful and Baba Yaga. Vasilisa was kicked out of her hut by her evil stepmother and stepsisters to go look for a light in the house of the witch of the forest, Baba Yaga. Vasilisa didn't really want to go into the forest, but she took heart and she did it anyway, and the adventure strengthened her character. So you can go check out that video after this one in the link that I am going to drop in the description box. But there are other characters that go into the forest willingly. In one of my favorite ballads, Tam Lin, the heroine, Janet, gets told that if she goes into the forest, she will encounter a dangerous elf who will seduce her, with all the negative consequences that a girl at the time might experience. And Janet decides to go into the forest anyway, and chooses to put herself through adventure and hardship. She becomes pregnant, then saves her lover. In folklore in general, the forest is a place of both great danger and great possibility. It's a place that people wouldn't normally go to. Beyond the houses, the fields, it's a space beyond human control. In there, the protagonist of a story could find an evil witch set on eating them, or an enchanted, beautiful swan maiden, or perhaps refuge to help them escape an evil ruler, like in Robin Hood. We don't know what we may find when we go beyond the carefully laid bounds of what we can manage and control. I'm certainly guilty of becoming a creature of habit, avoiding things things that make me feel uncomfortable, like phone calls and talking to strangers and even making videos. But if we don't go into the forest and make ourselves uncomfortable, we are never going to meet new possibilities. We are never going to grow. The idea of living a life that is stale and monotonous is even more scary. Do you agree? Let me know in the comments. Be who you are and do not mind the rest. In folk stories, the characters that have grisly endings are those who, instead of walking their own paths, are always looking over the shoulder at other people and try to meddle and imitate someone else. Cinderella's stepsisters, in a wonderfully gruesome ending, slice off their toes and heels in order to try and fit their foot in Cinderella's slipper and marry the prince. But of course they can't, and besides, well, being rather maimed, they are also punished. And what about characters that do pay attention to that inner voice? In the aforementioned ballad Tamlin, Janet, after her amorous activities with the elf in the forest, becomes pregnant and is in pretty dire straits because single mothers were a no-no at the time. But still, she refuses the easy way out and doesn't allow her father to find her a husband who will pretend the baby is theirs. Instead, she says that no knight will give the baby his name and goes back into the forest and saves her lover from the fairy queen who had enchanted him in the form of an elf. Janet manages to turn him back into a human knight who she then marries. Sometimes it feels a bit silly to say listen to your own inner voice, and I'm not telling you you shouldn't pay attention to other people's opinions or advice, kind of making an advice video right now. I think putting other people's voices before our own is the source of a lot of our unhappiness. I was raised in a Christian cult, and I'm not saying that all Christianity is a cult or that you shouldn't believe in Christianity, but it wasn't right for me and I knew it for a really long time. There was something in me, something that wanted to look for spiritual truth somewhere else, the light and the sky, the gleaming trees and the stars in the night. But I covered that up for a long time because people I trusted said that Christianity was the only right way, then surely it had to be so. I ended up leaving the church. But this happened with a great deal of struggle. If I could go back, I would have done it sooner, but it was worth it. I'm not gonna say that I'm in contact with the source of all knowledge, but I am comfortable in finding my own truths. And this applies not only to spirituality, but relationships, a career. Maybe you want to be a beekeeper, but you think that you should climb the corporate ladder. Or maybe you think that you have to save the bees, but you really want to be a CEO. Maybe you want to move to the countryside, but you're afraid. Or you want to wear a funny hat. Speaking of funny hats, word of advice, wear your flower crowns while you can. Was any of these pieces of folktale advice helpful to you? If you liked it, tap the like button, don't forget to subscribe and ring the notification bell, and tell me in the comments if there is any other folktale advice that you can think of, and see ya next Friday! My sexual urge to always have a beverage at hand. Is there a leaf in my hair? There's always a leaf in my hair. Hey, Benina! What are you doing? For pretty cool... They're food. Fit to the food.